Do embryos show evidence of evolution? Welcome to Critical Thinking Scan, where we look at how you can think about any faith-challenging message and arrive at a biblical, logical conclusion yourself. I'm Patricia Engler, and today let's begin part one of two videos on how to think critically about another top example textbook cite as evidence for evolution, which is similarities across different kinds of embryos. Now, you might have heard of the famous forged illustration by 19th century biologist Ernst Haeckel, which supposedly showed similarities between embryos of different organisms, including fish, chickens, and humans at various stages. And Haeckel suggested that embryos reenact evolution during their development. For example, a human embryo would go through a fish stage, an amphibian stage, and so on. Now, Haeckel himself admitted his drawings were fraudulent, making embryos appear more similar than they really are. Even so, Haeckel's drawings continued circulating in textbooks until at least the 1990s, with comparative embryology still being presented as evidence for evolution today, even in my own university textbooks. Instead of touting Haeckel's false claim that whole embryos reenact evolution, however, my textbook simply taught that similarities between embryos are evidence of evolution, or that parts of developing embryos reflect their supposed evolutionary history. For example, my evolution textbook talked about the similarity of many tetrapod vertebrates embryos, all which display pharyngeal clefts or gill slits, a notochord, that's a rod of something like cartilage which becomes the backbone in vertebrates, segmentation, and paddle-like limb buds before the features typical of their class or order become apparent. The book went on to admit that pharyngeal clefts, which the book also called gill slits in mammals and reptiles, never acquire the form typical of adult fishes. Now that's quite an understatement, as we'll see in a minute. But the text concluded, "Embryological similarities provided Darwin with some of his most important evidence of evolution, however, and they continue to shed important light on how characteristics have been transformed during evolution." So, is it true that these supposed similarities in embryos are prime evidence for evolution? Let's think about it. Check number one of critical thinking is check scripture. Genesis explains that God created living things to reproduce according to their kinds. So while we wouldn't be surprised if a good designer created many good designs like notochords that apply to multiple types of organisms, like all the vertebrates, we wouldn't expect that one kind of vertebrate could change into another. That would clearly contradict a teaching of scripture, which is check number two, check the challenge. For check three, check the source, we can keep in mind where this message is coming from. Besides clearly starting from the worldview foundation of man's word instead of God's, my textbook happened to be quite anti-creation, and even included an entire chapter attacking biblical creation. So we can expect the book will apply the most evolutionary interpretations possible to facts from observational science, and that's going to be important to keep in mind later in the critical thinking process. For check four, check the definitions, let's think about one of the main key words here, which is similarities. How are we defining what counts as similar? Do we mean the embryo's body parts look similar, or develop similar ways, or are expressed by similar genes? This is an important question, because as we'll continue to see in the next video, how you define similarity affects which conclusions you reach and what kind of evolutionary family tree you end up with. Moving on to step five, check for propaganda. We can ask what aspects of this message's presentation make it sound persuasive. For example, Haeckel used misleading propaganda by drawing embryos to look more similar than they really were. And today, textbooks sometimes use wording to make embryos sound more alike than they really are. For instance, did you notice my textbook called pharyngeal clefts gill slits or clefts? Pharyngeal clefts are actually neither gills nor slits. They're folds of tissue near an embryo's head. And human pharyngeal clefts don't turn into lungs or have anything to do with the embryo's breathing. Instead, they develop into different structures of the head and neck. But calling these tissue folds gill slits anyway is a propaganda technique of association to make humans seem more closely related to fish than we really are. We'll move on to check six in the next video. But meanwhile, for more on how to think critically about faith-challenging messages, you can access my other CT scan episodes packed with tactics, tips, and tools that helped me as a Christian student at secular university. Thank you for watching. Hey, it's Patricia. Just wanted to let you know that if you like these videos, are on board to share the message of biblical authority, and want to give, you're welcome to help Answers in Genesis produce more content like this and equip more people to defend their faith by making a one-time donation or becoming a monthly supporter by clicking the link below. Thanks so much.